Yeah, I'm pretty much done with it at this point. I'm reading about the blood of Christ. When we get to that, it'll be interesting. It's very interesting.
Okay.
But one of the ideas, even if remember in the American President, where Michael Douglas says to Martin Sheen, "We didn't have anything to eat, but I thought there was a connection." You never saw the American President? God. Well, there's a scene where he's talking about Annette Bening, and Annette is this young, vivacious woman that's come into the White House, right? And so he's trying to decide if he has any chance with her. And so he's talking to his chief of staff, who's Martin Sheen, and he says to him, "Well, we didn't have anything to eat, but I thought there was a connection." And so when I'm reading in Ego and Archetype, it's talking about the fact that when people eat together and share wine together, it creates a bond. And so for the first time, I'm really starting to get it. You know, I knew it, but sort of. I mean, I certainly have taken a lot of girls out to dinner over the years. Unlike our vice president, who can't trust himself.
Kidding, amazing. I didn't hear that.
I missed it.
No,
I saw like a clip. I had no idea what it was referencing. I didn't dig into the.
Oh, he says that he cannot trust himself to be alone with a woman not his wife.
Oh my.
So he.
He needs some Jung training.
Well, you know what this is a sign of? It's a sign of immaturity.
And repression.
And repression, yeah.
I mean, it's really kind of sad.
Because if you, and you know, that's really, we have this spectrum of whether people are ethical or not. And he's obviously has to live by the law. He has to live by the Jewish dispensation, which says, you know, you can't touch a woman, you can't look at her, you know. And
that's no different than the Arabs.
Yeah, that's where the Muslims are, right? With, so, you know, women covering.
What does that mean?
You had that happen in
devalue women.
You had it happen where?
After all, what are you doing here?
Well, exactly. I was on a sales call years ago, and a Muslim man told me he couldn't shake my hand. I'm here in a professional capacity. I know as much as any of the guys in my company, but he couldn't shake my hand, so he saw me as that first.
Well, and
it kind of took me aback. I mean, I wasn't terribly offended.
Well, if we look at it in terms of cultural maturity, this is what it is.
But you got to wonder what's going through his mind to where he's so afraid, you know, to.
I don't think there's anything much different going through their mind, except they still accept.
Well, he's much more sensitive to it.
Well, they accept.
It's fun to ride the surf, you know.
Yeah. Well, they accept.
Well, he stopped the waves.
Well, yeah.
Well, that reminds me of, remember Ashcroft when he started running the FBI under Bush Senior, I think it was. First thing he did was he went and covered up all the nude statues in the building.
Oh yeah, yeah. That's
so bizarre. This is works. These are works of art, and you got to cover them up.
Like, what's your mind doing?
Even if they're not, you know, it's just it's weird.
Well, okay, so it's Winston Churchill had this great quote, which is Americans always find the right answer after trying everything else, right? Okay,
but
Winston Churchill.
Oh, Churchill.
Okay, and he was half American. You understand?
Oh, that's right.
He was half American and later made an honorary American, but. But his mother was an American heiress from Baltimore, Jenny Jerome.
See, all these powerful men had rich parents, or rich wives.
And, well, and her her husband, Lord Randolph Churchill, got syphilis the night before their wedding.
Oh, that was awesome.
Right. Yeah. And so she didn't have sexual relations with him after the, like, the first month they were married. And pardon?
Yeah, was it?
Yeah, I mean,
Winston.
Yeah, they squeezed in Winston, and, but his brother Jack wasn't Randolph's son. It was Jenny's son, but not Randolph's. Jenny was quite the girl about town.
She was still surfing.
Yeah, Jenny was quite the girl about town during her later life, but and quite the reputation for it too. But I think the point is that if you don't allow yourself to try things, and that's where the strength of America has come, that we've allowed people enough space. And in that video that guy was talking about it today, where we've allowed people enough space to make mistakes and to disagree without having to come to blows over it. And because we allow space for that within our culture, that's what's made us very strong. And that's why Churchill said, you know, Americans always find the right answer after trying everything else. The problem with other cultures is they haven't tried anything else. So point number 8 now, which is paragraph 600. The unconscious has an animal nature, behavior of an unconscious being that can't be judged morally. So Yahweh is an unconscious being that can't be judged by good and evil because it's nature. And so even in Ezekiel says God is 3/4 animal and 1/4 human. And so Edinger, page 51, says Yahweh is a phenomenon, and as Job says, not a man. And then there's this remarkable footnote, number 13, quote, the naive assumption that the creator of the world is a conscious being must be regarded as a disastrous prejudice, which later gave rise to the most incredible dislocations of logic. You have to say so, don't you? No wonder Mrs. Schmidt's ancestors were rebelling as she was typing this manuscript. Can you imagine?
What's the relationship between God's, well, the consciousness that is usually ascribed to God, and omniscience?
God has no consciousness.
In other words, all-knowing, right, omnipotent, and supposedly omniscient.
Well, all knowing, because each of us has a little chip out of God in us. Okay, that's what the self is. And so, yes, God is conscious as long as there's a man there.
He's like all information, but he can't do anything with it.
Right.
So he's like the Serengeti, that when Jung went and stood before the Serengeti, he's basically nature.
Right. And it's not there until consciousness knows it's there. One of the things that Jung says in this thing is that, you know, there's 1,000 million years pass to create humans. Right?
So what changes when man looks at untamed God then?
Well, then you realize that untamed God can be both good and evil. In other words,
that's what Job is doing.
You know,
it doesn't change Yahweh's composition at all.
You know, if a
right.
Pardon?
Like a blind
doesn't no, change. I mean, Yahweh.
You're saying we have a piece of God in us,
right? Which is developed
back
from the beginning of life to us. Now there's consciousness, but only full consciousness is only in human beings.
But it's more like a stream. You're channeling the portions of God that you're not.
Right.
You don't have a, like, you know, raw stake laid in there.
Yahweh is Yahweh. So he has good and bad. You know, he creates health and he creates sickness, both. Okay. And so, you know, he creates rats, which when they were running around in Venice and Florence, for the rats it was pretty okay the way we were living at that time. They, you know, they were taking over the place, right? And so from the rats' point of view, it was a good deal, right? But from the human point of view, they were getting the Black Plague, right? and so that's Yahweh being both good and evil. He's good to the rats, but he was pretty bad to the humans until the humans got enough consciousness to say, duh, maybe it's the rats.
Yeah, see, even so, Yahweh wasn't good or evil. He's just ugly.
He's above good and evil.
He's not even in the same arena.
Right. Not, that's the point.
Well, he's what the deists saw him as then.
Pardon?
What you're saying is he's basically what the deists saw him as. He started everything in motion and just went and played golf. And let it all
Run. Except he didn't go and play golf because he had no consciousness that he could.
He didn't even know he let it go.
Yeah,
until we told him.
I think this the rabbinical story that Jung used to tell is God simply took a handful of dice out of his pocket, threw it on the ground and said, let there be a world. That's what it amounted to.
So what about all these supposed order in the world?
We imposed it on the world.
One thing that Michio Kaku is right about is every atom is connected to every other atom in the universe. Right?
I think every bit of consciousness is connected with all other consciousness in the universe.
It doesn't have to be both at the same time. You have to have the physical order, and you also have to have the psychic chaos.
Both of those are not real.
Right. There's the psyche took 1,000,000,000 years to come into being. Yeah, it gives us access to power for one thing, right? Because we can figure out how to burn coal or whatever it is, or how to make nuclear energy.
But one objective psyche would be social, society.
Right.
The consensual hallucination, rituals, the rites.
Well, and that's the psychic container, isn't it? And the guys that we're looking at on the video today are saying, you know, every so often your psychic container gets so sclerotic that you have to have a war to make anything happen, right? And
those are ritualistic wars he's talking about.
Right, and in the Red Book is full of blood, okay?
And snakes.
Right. But you know, stuff has to happen to break up sclerosis, right? Okay, so
like grist for the mill type thing.
Well, if things get rigidified, then something will happen to break that up. Something does happen to break it up. It's not allowed to continue forever. I mean, even the earth and everything any human being ever knew 4 billion years from now is going to get burned up in the sun. Okay, and we even know that, right? And
Skip is a real cheer you up type.
but the point is, if you know that's coming, then you might as well be happy now and enjoy it. It's not going to be my problem.
Okay.
And I hope my progeny are off Earth by the time that happens, but I'm not going to worry about it terribly much.
Mars is going to come close to
exactly.
So we real hot on Mars.
But we probably have a couple thousand million years to figure it out.
Is that right. Lucy in a nutshell, the movie?
I think Lucy is more about we're all players in the great mosaic, and we each have a part.
We each have to maintain an existential integrity.
How do we make our part count? And this is Jung's idea too, that we have to decide for ourselves what the meaning of our life is. Now, it can be, the meaning can be as simple as we have children. And so we pass the problem down the line so that something may happen in the future, right? And sometimes we don't have children, like Debbie and her brother haven't had any kids of their own, right? And so, but maybe that's a good thing because their father had Parkinson's disease, right, from age 57. So, but then you have the other side of Lucy, which is the immortality part, which is what Lucy was doing, was passing her knowledge down the generations. So she put her piece of the mosaic in, which was because she had this 24 hours of 100% knowledge. She knew a lot of things, and she put it all on a thumb drive, which she handed to Morgan Freeman. And then she disappeared. And then they said, "Where is she?" Everybody's cell phone lights up and says, "I am everywhere."
That's what I thought. It was like what you were saying with the movie Lucy.
Yeah. Oh, Lucy, yeah.
Because when you said that, made me think of that, just becoming more physical reality, but like Lucy, it's like she still went on.
Her spirit went on, and this is what Bill was saying,
okay.
That we're really like Sony video players, right?
We're just playback
machines for something that's going on in the universe. Okay, you don't have any thoughts of your own. You can't think up anything by yourself. Okay. No, thoughts come.
Keep it in the same way.
No thoughts of your own.
That's what he was like.
Right. But thoughts come constantly. They come, and we notice that they're here. Okay. But we can't make them come. I can't predict what my next sentence is going to be. Right? Not at all. But it comes, and you'll all notice what it is when it comes, right? Okay, so Edinger says about this. We're talking about the unconscious has an animal nature. Okay, so this is point eight. The unconscious has an animal nature. Edinger says, Jung goes on to say in this footnote that when we understand that what we are dealing with is divine unconscious and lack of reflection, then we are enabled to form a conception of God which puts his actions beyond moral judgment and allows no conflict to arise between goodness and beastliness. Okay, so God is above good and evil. God is, if you say that the divine unconscious lacks the ability to reflect on itself, then it's beyond good and evil. And so when we were looking at, and we keep looking at this eagle mama, my eagle mama, okay? But she's living the mother archetype in this picture because she's got three eggs under her, but she's covered with snow up to here, right? So she's got good under her and bad around her, but she's living the mother archetype, which is godly, okay? And which is the transpersonal power, right? And so women typically understand this, I would think, better than men, but men too, when I was on active duty becoming a Marine and being a warrior, I was definitely taken up by the warrior archetype at that time. And I knew that I was participating in something greater than myself. It didn't have anything to do with the rightness or wrongness of the Vietnam War. It had to do with participating in something that was transpersonal, that was greater than myself. And I don't necessarily feel that today except as memory. But certainly at that time I was feeling it. And I'm sure you would say that when you were a mother, when you were first a mother, you were definitely carried away by that, right? By being a mother. And so that's what we're talking about. And that's this girl's issue, you know? She's carried away with the process of being a mother. And this morning we saw her chicks being hatched. So she's got chicks under her now. Okay. All right, so beyond moral judgment, beyond good and evil. What Jung is describing here is the nature of the unconscious. This is not metaphysical theology that he is indulging in. It is empirical psychology. Jung is describing what he knows from his own experience. Okay, So all of what we're talking about when we're talking about answer to Job is the psychological perspective on this story of Job. Okay, so paragraph 601, the therapeutic measure of unresisting acceptance had proved its value once again. This shows Dr. Jung was analyzing Job's story. Dr. Jung was analyzing Job's story from a psychological point of view, something few theologians grokked, okay? The theologians didn't get that. They thought he was attacking their metaphysical way of thinking about it, and it wasn't. But that's what everybody thought, and probably everybody up until Edinger started to pull it together and say, oh my God, this is what this guy was doing in all this work over the years. Okay, so paragraph 602, the protagonists back away from one another. 603, from our modern point of view, we don't have an answer to the satanic prank. We don't have an answer to this bet between God and Satan. Job has not so much answered as reacted in an adjusted way. In so doing, he displayed remarkable self-discipline, but an unequivocal answer has still to be given. Okay, so paragraph 604, what about the moral wrong Job has suffered? Yahweh needs Job's loyalty. Yahweh needs Job's loyalty, attaches almost divine importance to man. What to you... Oh. It's not what to, it's what do. What do you give someone who has everything? Yahweh, quote, reacts irritably to every word that has the faintest suggestion of criticism. While he himself does not care a straw for his own moral code if his actions happen to run counter to its statutes. Right? So this is the issue with megalomania too. Right? Megalomaniacs don't care about what the rules are.
It's the inflation.
Yeah, it's the inflation, basically. Okay.